Hello simulation friends and welcome to another add-on aircraft tutorial in X-Plane 11. And today we are going to fly the FlyJSIM 732 Twinjet version 3 Pro, which is a replica of the Boeing 737-200. And even though one might not believe it, some of these very old aircraft types are still in service today by a couple of airlines, mostly in remote places around the world, like in Africa, the Middle East, Indonesia, and also where we are going to fly today, in Canada. And as you can see, we are going to fly in Air Inuit colors today, an airline based in Canada. And they are still operating, I think, four of these classic 737-200s. And they are flying from bigger hubs, like here in Montreal, where we are situated at the moment, to very remote places in northern Canada, for example. And this is also a route we are going to fly today. So even though this is a classic aircraft, we are going to fly a real-world route today from Montreal Pierre Elliott Trudeau International Airport, Charlie Yankee Uniform Lima, to La Grande Rivière Airport in northern Canada, Charlie Yankee Golf Lima, and it's going to be a very frosty flight. As you can see right here in Montreal, it's snowing already. I think it's negative 6 degrees right here, Celsius. But we are really going to freeze at our destination airport, where it should be around negative 30 degrees Celsius right now. And for this purpose, I installed the winter season modification for X-Plane 11. As you can see, the default textures have been replaced with white snowy textures. So this time for this flight I will not use Auto4XP photoreal coverage, but this winter seasons mod. And I will put a link for it down in the description, if you want to check it out as well. And now let's start taking a look at this study level classic airliner for X-Plane 11. And here we are in the cockpit of the Boeing 737-200. And as you can see, there are only very few similarities to modern Boeing 737s, which can be mostly found at the overhead. The main layout of the overhead hasn't changed too much over the years, but everything else is quite different, especially the flight director and autopilot operation. Also, the navigation is very old school right here. As you can see, we have completely analog instruments, but we have a modern FMS installed, which we can use for the route, so we don't have to do complete VOR or NDB flying. And we have a weather radar with a display, and everything else is very classic. The relatively new version 3 Pro also comes with a virtual cabin that looks quite nice. Also with some retro touch right here. And now let's have a look at the menus first. They are right here at the left hand side and they will appear when you hover the mouse over the left side of the screen. And these six buttons right here will cover all the functions we need. The first one is the takeoff and landing speed card that we are going to use later. The second one is the weight and balance. We will deal with that in a second. The third one are the options. Then there's a menu for the doors operation. As you can see, the main forward entry and the air stairs are opened, as well as the forward and aft cargo doors. And these have to be opened to load the plane, that we are going to do in a second. This wrench icon is a maintenance system. So this aircraft features damage. So if you abuse it, several components can take damage, like the airframe, the engines, and the APU. But I have flown this plane only once until now, so everything's like new. And the last icon right here is the checklist. It's a very condensed and not too detailed checklist, but for quick reference it's quite useful. And now let's start to bring this aircraft to life. First of all, we are going to switch on the battery. And we make sure that the parking brake is set. And now we are going to the options page and we will connect the GPU card and the air card as well. And now we can connect the ground power right here. Now let's turn on the galley power. Arm the emergency exit lights and the window heats come on. The Gasper fans can come on. The isolation valve to open. All the bleeds come on. And when the external air card is connected, it will provide PSI to the right pack, so we will turn that on. We can also set up the pressurization. Our flight altitude will be 28,000. And landing will be... approximately 650 feet. And we are also going to turn on the position light. And as you can hear, passengers are boarding already. So let's turn on the no smoking signs. And we will close the cockpit's door. Now let's take a look at the weight and balance window. And right here you can manually click each of these compartments to fill in passengers or cargo. And for today's flight we are aiming at a zero fuel weight of 84.5. At the moment it's 85.7. There's also the possibility to click these full, empty or random buttons for fuel, passengers and cargo. But I'm not going to use those. We already have our zero fuel weight. Perfectly fine. And now comes the fuel. The total fuel will be 23.4. So I'm using these global plus and minus buttons right here. And today we also have some fuel in our center tanks. The flight isn't too long and we are not very heavily loaded. But I think we need that much fuel because the engines are so inefficient and they are burning lots of fuel. And you can see that at the moment we are too heavy for landing, but until landing I hope enough fuel will be burned and everything will be fine. So the weight and balance is set up, also our center of gravity is within limits, and we can close that window. And now let's get to the FMC. This isn't a fully fledged 737NG FMC. And not everything will work or have influence on the flight performance, because still this is a very classic and analog aircraft. But we can use it to punch in a route and fly these waypoints like with a modern aircraft. We have a general status page with the active nav data, X-plane version. By the way, I'm using the newest X-plane version 1130. And there may occur some problems with this version of the aircraft, because it hasn't been updated to fully support X-plane 1130 until now. And to get to our flight plan page, this works a lot different than in a modern 737. So you have to go to the route menu, and to the pilot route list, and then to flight plan. And here we can enter our departure airport and destination airport. Flight number is Alpha India Echo for Air Inuit 704. And now let's go to departure and arrival. Departing. Runway 6 left. There's only one sit available at Montreal and it's a vectored sit. So no sit waypoints. We could fly with this aircraft. As you can see, it reads vectors. Now let's go to the next page. And we will go direct TAMCO. And then direct LIFBA. And no soot. No soot. And IGNAR. And VANCI. And that's the route. Now going to departure and arrival, and arriving. We are planning for an RNF runway 13, because there's no ILS at this remote airport. And from Tirut. And that's great. So our flight plan is punched in, as well as the arrival. And now let's go to VNAV, and I don't think that will have any impact on the flight performance of the aircraft, because everything will be handled manually and very hands-on. So the most useful function of the FMC will be the legs page. I'm going to fix this discontinuity right there. And everything's looking fine. So now let's set our altimeters. 2980 at the moment, right here. And for the co-pilot as well. We can also flick this switch right here to GPS. And that will change the navigation source from traditional VOR flying to our FMC flight plan. And after departure we are planning to fly runway heading for some time, so let's set up our flight director. When switching the flight director knob to heading, you can see the flight director bar appear, this V-shape bar. We are going to set the pitch command to 15 degrees. Let's set it up like this after departure for our initial climb. And heading will be 057 as the runway heading. So our navigation should be set so far. So the aircraft is loaded up and we can close the doors, closing the forward entry and then retracting the air stairs. And the cargo doors can be closed as well. Now let's start the APU. Fuel pump on and click and hold the APU start switch and it should fire up. And you could see the APU gen light is available. We can also check right here that the APU gen provides power. And we can flick these two APU gen switches. We can now go to the options and disconnect the air card and the ground power unit. And since APU is now providing PSI to our pressurization, we are going to switch off the right pack and turn on the left pack instead. We can also look right now at our V-speed card. And I'm going to select flaps 5 for takeoff. And there are several important information right here. Since this aircraft doesn't have an auto throttle or any assistance of any kind for limiting the takeoff power, we definitely need our EPR and our N1 limit settings right here. So we can set these up when departing and the engines won't explode or catch fire. We get our trim value that we can set a bit later, after engine start. Our V1, V-rotate and V2 values. And the speed bugs have been set automatically. The first one is 80 knots, then V-rotate, VR plus 20 for our initial climb after liftoff. And this one right here could be our climb speed after reaching 3000 feet or something. So until 1000 feet above the ground we will climb with VR plus 20, about here. I'm going to set our speed bug to that speed as well. 142 is V2 and 162 is V2 plus 20. And at 1000 feet above ground we will accelerate to 210 to 220 knots. We also get our flap retraction speeds, flaps up at 190. And some other values like the zero fuel weight, the fuel on board, gross weight, temperature and altimeter, and that's all fine. And today I won't be flying with ATC, because XLIFE doesn't support the small La Grande Rivière airport, and so I can't use it. So let's just assume that we got clearance for our flight. I'm going to set up some squawk, switching it to on altitude. And our first climb altitude I will set to 10,000. And now let's prepare the aircraft for engine start. So your damper comes on. The fuel pumps come all on. Center also, because we have fuel in the center tanks today. That's all fine. Galley power is on. APU gens are on. Fasten seatbelts come on. The electrical hydraulic pumps and the pressurization and air conditioning, that all looks fine. Let's have a quick look outside if everything's fine. All ground equipment is removed, doors are closed. That's great. And a cool feature about the FlyJSIM732 is the ground call button. If you push and hold it, then better pushback will be activated. So we will push back straight and then tail to the left. And we are ready for pushback.
Starting pushback, can you may start engines?
And this works just like in the modern 737. Let's put on the anti-collision light. PECS off. And we can start the right engine. The N2 dial is this one right here, and at 15% to 20% we will add fuel with this lever. And there we are. Oil pressure is rising. So these instruments right here on the right hand side, this row and this row is for the right engine. And the left row right here, and this one is for the left engine. Down here we have the fuel quantity gauges. So it's all a bit old school right here. And the igniter snapped back to the auto or off position, so we can start the left engine. So these gauges right here are for the oil, the pressure, temperature and quantity. And right here we have the EPR, internal engine pressure. These have to be kept within limits during takeoff, as well as the N1. So you can see there are limits to these values. And we should definitely not get into the red during takeoff. And we have the exhaust gas temperature. N2 and the fuel flow.
We'll see you next time and have a safe flight.
And pushback is complete, so let's do the afterstart checks. Gens are providing power, so let's connect them. APU bleed off. Isolation valve auto and PECS on. This will give us air conditioning from the engines. Pitot statics come on, and we can turn off the APU. Turn on the taxi light. For a normal conditions takeoff, so when it's not freezing, we would switch these igniters right here to low ignition. But since we have negative 6 degrees Celsius and we will encounter some icing in the clouds, I'm switching them to flight and put the engine anti-ice.
to on.
We can now switch the pressurization mode to flight. And setting flaps 5. The takeoff trim can be set by just clicking this green area right here. It will automatically set the trim. And we can turn on the weather radar. And we'll see if that works with FS Global Real Weather that I'm using. Because it should definitely get some returns. Let's do quick control checks. And that should all be fine. So I think we are ready for taxiing. And we have reached our hold short runway 6 left. And now preparing the aircraft for takeoff. All the lights come on, except the logo light. Transponder to TARA. Since we are doing an FMC flight, for now we don't need to set up any VORs. By the way, there is no RTO autobrake in this classic 737. So I hope everything is set up. And now let's taxi to the runway. So initially we will fly runway heading 057, so that's all set. Pitch command is 10 to 15 degrees up. Speedbugs are set. Right here we will rotate at 137 and this is VR plus 20, which we are going to maintain after takeoff. GPS navigation is active. 10,000 feet is our first climb altitude. So now let's take off and see what will happen.
Knots.
2.15 is our EPRS setting, and we have a lot of crosswind from the right.
P1, rotate.
Trying to maintain V2 plus 20, we are a bit too fast. And we have reached 1000 feet above ground. So N1 will come back to 90%. And we will accelerate to 210 knots approximately, pitching down a bit. And let's turn on the autopilot. And we are going to say heading select, maybe. The pitch can be adjusted by using the yoke. Now let's turn left. Don't forget to retract the flaps. And there we see some nice winter landscape. And now let's go direct to Temco. Flaps up by now, and I selected VOR lock right here on the autopilot panel. And now we are going to follow our FMC route towards Temco. N1 is set at 90%, that's good for climb. And we can pitch down a bit more using the yoke. And when we reach 250 knots, we can engage IAS mode right there. So right now, and now we should be climbing at 250 knots. And let's dial in our cruise altitude. And we have reached 10,000 feet. So I'm going to reset the climb speed to about 280 knots. And the aircraft will pitch down, unfortunately, to level off, and then continue climbing at 280 knots. And we turn off the landing lights and the seatbelt signs. So now we are climbing at about 280 knots. Still flying towards our first waypoint, Temco, 12 miles out. Keeping an eye at our temperatures. Everything's looking fine. Right here we can verify that the pressurization is working. So it's climbing as it should. And we have reached our first waypoint, and now we are flying towards Lifbar, only 10 miles out. So in VOR loc mode and this switch right here set to GPS, the aircraft will follow the flight plan in the FMC. So the departure was relatively hectical. I didn't fly this plane in a very long time, so by no means I'm doing it all perfectly fine. I have to get used to this aircraft again. And all the operation with the autopilot and the flight director, that's all something you have to get used to, without a doubt. And we have reached 18,000, and we can go standard pressure. 2992. And you have to set it for the co-pilot as well. And the climb rate is pretty low right now at 240. So let's push the engines a bit more. 92% and one is fine. And as you can see, we are flying through some very high altitude cloud cover right here. 27,000 feet high. And I hope we don't stay into this soup during the whole cruise. And there we see the fuel master caution has come on. And that's because the center fuel tanks are empty right now. And we turn off the fuel pumps. Now fuel will be fed from the wing tanks left and right. And we are very slowly approaching our cruise altitude. And altitude hold should turn green, right here. And there we have altitude capture. And since there is no auto throttle, we are going to accelerate to about 0.74 to 0.76 mark. And then we are going to pull the throttles back a little, so we will maintain that speed. And it looks like we are really flying into the soup at the moment. So I'm sorry that this flight will not offer too much from a visual point of view. But it's winter in Canada, so what to expect. And we are approaching 0.75 mark, so I'm going to put the speed bug right there as a visual reference. And we will have to manage our throttles ourselves to maintain that speed. And there we are, cruising at 280, flying towards Vansea. It's still 185 nautical miles out, and then another 147 miles towards our first approach waypoint. So I will be back when we are doing our descent calculations. So one advice I can give for classic airliners is to definitely take note of a VOR frequency. So from a VOR that is close to the arrival airport. And luckily in our case there is one. So let's dial in the new frequency into NEV2. It's 112.2. Transfer it with this switch so it's active. And when we are within reach of this VOR, the distance will appear right here for DME2. DME-1 is occupied by the FMC flight plane. And with the DME-2 we will get the distance to the VOR. And there it is. So it's 160 miles out to the airport itself. So that's good to know. And the descent calculations for classic airliners to know when to start the descent can be done as follows. In this case we know that we want to be at 2000 feet by TDUT, this waypoint right here. You can see that the next one is only 5 nautical miles away from this one, and we have to be at 1900 by then, so it's good to be at 2000 when reaching TDUT. And finally we are past this cloud layer, and now we can see some blue skies. That's really great. So back to our descent calculations. We know that we want to be at 2000 feet after the descent, and we are at 28,000 right now. So we subtract 2000 from 28,000 and we have 26,000. And we will take away the zeros, the last three digits. We have 26, and we will multiply 26 times 3. And then we get 78. So when descending at a normal descent rate for an airliner, which is about 2000 feet a minute, we need 78 miles to descend from 28,000 to 2000. So I will initiate our descent approximately at a little above 80 miles out from the VOR, and that should work pretty well. And as you can see, we are 87 miles out from our airport. So I will resync the speed bug with our current speed. And then for the autopilot, arm IAS mode. Resetting the altitude, 2000 feet. And now pulling back the throttles and we should start our descent. And there we go, slowly, to a descent rate of 2000 feet. And that's what I'm trying to maintain. As we are here, we can set up the decision height for the arrival airport, which is approximately 400 feet. This is done with this yellow mark. And this yellow light and this altitude alert will light up when below the setup decision height. And we are below 18,000 feet again, which is the transition altitude. 2989 is the barrow for our arrival airport. So that's set. At the moment we are descending at about 280 knots and idle thrust. And now let's try a different method to slow the aircraft down during descent, instead of just readjusting this speed bug, and the plane will level off. That's not great. We are going to exit IAS mode, switch it to off, readjust the heading or the speed bug, 240 knots approximately, and now we can use the yoke to readjust our descent rate, and you have to be very smooth. It's very sensitive. Approximately 1,000 feet per minute. And we are slowly decelerating. We can deploy some speed brake. And we are below 10,000 feet. Let's put on the landing lights. And the seatbelt signs. And we have reached 250 knots. So at 245 I will disengage the speed brake and return to IAS mode. And we are just 17 miles out to Tidut. We should be at 2000 feet by then and relatively slow. So let's deploy the speed brake again. You can see the vertical speed increases very much with speed brakes extended and IAS descent mode. And we are through the clouds. You can see the snow covered ground. And I'm going to set up final approach heading already. It's 129. So this time we won't have an ILS. And I can show you the approach mode, the glide slope capture. Maybe I'm doing it separately and show you after this flight how that works. And we have nearly made it. Let's enter our intercept altitude. And again I'm exiting IAS mode to reduce the descent rate manually. And it's quite bumpy right here. And one thing I have noticed with this aircraft in X-Plane 1130 is that the side menus disappear after some time, after an hour or something. You can't open them again. So that's unfortunate. This will be a very short runway. I will arm the autobrake to medium. We are flying about 180 knots right now. And since we don't have the V-speed card available, I'm going to assume a approach speed. And at 0.6 miles to MPIL, we will start our descent towards the runway. So we are doing about 160 knots right now. It's okay. Flaps 10. 5 miles out to MPIL. We can arm the speed brakes. And right there we have the runway. Four miles out. So at MPIL we should be about 1700 feet. And I'm going to disengage altitude hold and the autopilot. And I'm going to fly the rest of the approach myself. So we start our descent. 3 degrees glide slope. And by now we can put the gear down, flaps 15. And turn on all the lights. I'm going to set flaps full. And I hope we are set for landing. Speed brake armed, auto brake armed, flaps full and gear down. Speed is looking fine. And we don't even have happy lights right here. Decision height is fine. Continue.
300.
And we are down. Not too happy with the landing, and the thrust reverser still don't work for me. I think I have the correct assignment on my throttle quadrant, but somehow they won't deploy.
500.
So, speed brake is up and flaps are up. And let's clean up the aircraft. Start the APU, strobe off, wing light off, entire is off, and pressurization to ground. Pitot heats off. And transponder to altitude. And let's just take this spot right here. Taxi light off. I love these brake noises the aircraft makes. And that's it. And now let's shut down the aircraft. APU is running, so let's connect the gen. As well as the bleed air. Seatbelt signs off, and now let's shut down the engines. And the beacon comes off. Yaw damper, three fuel pumps, the electric hydraulic pumps, galley power can come off, and I think that's it. And unfortunately, due to the menu disappearance bug, I cannot open the doors or connect the GPU or anything. That's unfortunate. So right now I'm going to show you how to do an ILS approach. Now we are planning to land runway 24 right at Montreal, where we departed. So let's tune in the ILS frequency into NAV 1 and 2, which is 111.9. So these are set. At the moment we are doing heading select flying, so we can also tune in the correct course, which is 237. Like this. So NAV 1 and 2 are set, and the courses as well. And right here we have the DME to the ILS localizer. And we are flying back course at the moment. So we will turn right in a second. There are some crazy winds right now at Montreal, gusting about 40 knots, so this will be a rest in peace landing, I guess, but we'll see. And right here you can also see the landing speed card, which didn't work at the previous flight. So right here you select the landing flaps and it will give you a landing VREF, which will be marked right here as well, with this bug. Make sure that this switch right here is set to NAV for ILS approaches. And we are going to fly an intercept heading. So when this bar begins to move, I'm going to switch the autopilot to VOR lock. And there we go, it moves, so VOR lock. And now the aircraft should intercept this localizer course, 237. Now we can also set the heading to our landing approach heading. And this bug right here is the glide slope, and when this starts to move, we are going to go into auto glide slope capture mode, which is right here, auto approach. And we can see the glide slope bug is moving, so we are going to auto approach. And we have glide slope capture. This indicator turned green. So gear down and flaps 15. And now we are flying an automated ILS approach. So let's see how it goes. Autopilot off, and we are getting ready to suffer. And there we have another hard ILS landing. And that concludes our very frosty flight in Canada today. So I hope that you found this FlyJSim 732 tutorial at least a bit useful. And also for me it was quite a challenge to fly this aircraft again. It's very different to the usual airliners, but the flight worked well for the most part. And if you liked this video, then I would be very happy about some thumbs up and some comments. And if you didn't like something, then please let me know what it is, so I can improve in the next video. And if you would like to see more flight sim action in the future, then please don't forget to subscribe as well. And until next time, see ya!